Now is Dr. Robert Murphy, a professor of infectious diseases at Northwestern University Feinberg School of Medicine. Good morning, doctor.
Morning.
Big story is this J&J pause for some blood clots. Just a handful out of 7 million. How concerned should we be about that?
Well, it's very concerning because the Europeans also reported on April 9th, just a few days ago, kind of a similar thing. But the numbers are still, fortunately, very low. It's 6 people, all women, all with a very unusual blood clot, cerebral venous thrombosis. This is not a usual, I mean, this is a very rare kind of blood clot. It looks very suspicious that it's caused by the vaccine. Now, if you put it into perspective, of the 7 million people who've gotten the Pfizer vaccine, the Johnson & Johnson vaccine, say half of those are women, so 3.5 million women have had the vaccine. That's one in every 583,333 got one of these blood clots. One of those women died, one is seriously ill, the other four are doing okay. And the women are between 18 and 48, and it happened 6 to 16 days after the vaccine. So it's not something that looks like it's going to drag on for a long time. It looks like an acute reaction to the vaccine.
So could this have a major impact on setting us back and trying to get not just America vaccinated, but the rest of the world?
It's an understatement, Larry. This is going to have a profound effect, this and all the problems with AstraZeneca. You know, these companies now are stumbling. Now, you look at this a little closer, and there is a press conference by the FDA at 10 a.m. Eastern time today, so we'll hear more about this. You know, perhaps it's there's just a group of people that shouldn't take the vaccine. Perhaps it's, you know, women under 50 years of age, something like that. I mean, you know, I don't know if that's going to be the case, but we may find pockets in the population that can't take this vaccine, can't take that vaccine, and we're going to have to design our approach, our vaccine approach, more strategically when we have all the information at hand.
And perhaps a bit of good news, if I'm stretching here for good news. A study on the UK variant says not more severe.
Okay, Larry, I hate to blow your bubbles.
I tried.
I read those stories. Now, okay, that's great that they showed the 2 papers published in Lancet journals, not The Lancet, but one of their subsidiary journals, 2 different ones, Lancet Infectious Disease and Lancet Public Health. And they showed, yeah, the B117 is more transmissible. I think everyone has already agreed to that. The big question is it more lethal? So these 2 studies, they're good studies, and these are fine journals. You know, that's very encouraging. However, if you look at the people getting infected right now, they're younger people who have less comorbidities. So you really can't say that it's less lethal because the population was much healthier. So I think it's still questionable about lethality.
All right, let's get to some viewer questions. Here's the first one. I just read that the staff at Northwestern received 200 doses of vaccine that were due to expire. They were able to organize the doses to be administered to students. I can imagine this happens often. Do most places just toss the expiring doses in the trash?
I think that it's a sin to waste one dose. There was a case in Oregon several months ago where the people were transporting the vaccine. It was going to expire in a couple hours, and they jumped out of their car and they vaccinated people on the street. This is what should be done. You know, they didn't go over to Trump Tower and go vaccinate a bunch of people over there. They gave it to people just around them at the time. And this is what should be done. If there's extra vaccine and it's going to expire, it should be given out to whoever is available.
All right, here's the next question. The CDC said today that getting COVID from surfaces is so low that we should not disinfect surfaces anymore. Still, new guidelines suggest if someone has COVID-19, the area should be both cleaned and disinfected. How do we know?
Well, I mean, I think we just use common sense here. At the beginning of this pandemic, we really thought that the environment was a big cause of transmission. At the original estimates were that it's 6% environmentally transmitted. I don't think it's anywhere near 6%. But I think it's just good sanitation measures to, you know, keep clean. The virus is very easy to disinfect. Any kind of disinfectant, hot soap and water, or just soapy water actually disinfects it. So I think just common sense should be done.
All right, and I think we have time for one more question. After we are considered fully vaccinated, would it be safe to commute on the train or a bus to work, masked, of course?
Yes, there is really good data now looking at transmission on public transportation, transmission of the virus on public transportation, and it looks like it's not a big cause of transmission compared to bars, restaurants, gyms. We all hear about them. But on the public transportation, there's been really very little transmission. Now, granted, ridership is low, but it's increasing. But, you know, with everybody wearing a mask and trying to social distance as much as possible, 6 feet is ideal, but 3 feet is minimal. It is really safe, and it's you know, in certain states and cities, it's time to get back to work. And if you have to take public transportation, I think it's pretty fair to say that it's safe to travel on public transportation.
All right, doctor, thank you. If you have a question for Dr. Murphy, head to our Morning News Facebook page and post it there. We'll talk to him again tomorrow. Thank you, doctor.
Thank you. Have a good day, Larry.